doing something literally just for fun, but I promise you some deeply philosophical, witchy stuff will make it in here. We are doing my top favorite movies for the November's Eve season. So grab yourself a cider, hard or soft, I won't judge you, and let's jump into this episode. So first things first, as for the format, these are not going to be in any particular order because I really can't rank things that easily, but we're going to dive into some slightly more obscure movies that I think really resonate with the November's Eve season that are not your stereotypical ones that everybody lists on every freaking Pinterest pin ever. So for anybody who's new around here and doesn't know what November's Eve means and why I'm calling it that instead of calling it Halloween, is because on the Wheel of the Year, the Witch's Circular Calendar, this is the middle point between the autumn equinox and the winter solstice, and it's the time of year when we really start thinking about the concept of death and the life, death, rebirth cycle that is pervasive through the energies of everything in the universe. So naturally, each one of these movies we're going to be talking about has a little bit of that theme, and I'm going to go a little bit into why I think it's perfect for the November's Eve season and why anybody who is witchy and getting into the Wheel of the Year should really check these out. So, first things first, number one is The Crow. So, to be honest with you, the reason why I love The Crow first and foremost is just because it's a weird, gothic, very 90s grunge situation, and it's just deeply inspiring to me for purely aesthetic purposes. That being said, even though it's an extremely cheesy and bizarre sort of storyline, what's cool about it is that it kind of brings in that energy of the crow archetype. So if you're into spirit animals and stuff like that, you know that the crow in some traditions has a little bit to do with being that sort of bridge between life and death. You know, it's this very obviously alive and lively sort of animal, but it's always been said that it kind of is the forebearer of death. I know some people are actually super weirded out by crows because, like, they eat dead stuff and they're weird and they're like black and creepy, but I absolutely love them. And what's really great about crows is that, first of all, they're really intelligent, and I just value that. Anyway, if you want to really get into crow stuff, go to Jordana Van's channel and listen to the crow archetype videos that she has, and you'll understand me a little bit better. But for a short and sweet version of why I think the concept of the crow has to do with November's Eve season is because, one, it draws our attention to the concept of death, which is something in our culture we don't like to do, but we need to do in order to be sane and stuff and balance and stuff like that. But also because just in the grand scheme of nature, it's kind of a shadow work animal. It takes the gross, dead, decaying things that are laying around in our reality, and it does something useful with it. It eats it and turns it into sustenance for itself while also making it disappear from everyone else's reality. So I have a lot of respect for the crow because, you know, the crow the animal, not the crow the character. Because it serves as this sort of bridge between the worlds. It's not afraid to go where other animals are or other creatures are afraid to go, and it chews over and processes and transitions things so that the light can return to that concept, or, you know, that road where there was roadkill or whatever, however you want to look at that. And so the movie The Crow, even though it's obviously really dramatic and crazy, I feel like it evokes that kind of concept and gets you thinking about that sort of thing in a ridiculously action-packed and 90s gothic kind of way. Number two is Rosemary's Baby. Now, this is something that, like, I had always heard of the movie and didn't really know what it was about until I found it on Netflix or something like that about 5 or 6 years ago, I want to say. And I have to say that I really didn't like the movie that much. Honestly, it was made in the 60s and it's about witches, but I just felt like it was extremely, like, derogatory and what gave a very negative and one-sided view of what a witch is or what they do, which was very probably indicative of the time. But the reason why I list it as an interesting movie for this time of year is because it kind of, for those of us who are witches and see ourselves as these wonderful, magical, sparkly, happy creatures, it kind of reminds us of the duality of what it means to be a witch in society. And it kind of gets us thinking about the fact that, like, the world doesn't necessarily all see witches the way we want to see ourselves. And it's just interesting to see the way that culture has portrayed the concept of a witch throughout different points in history, particularly Hollywood in the 1960s. Movie number three is Interview with a Vampire. This one is hands down one of my favorites. If I was putting these in order, which I'm not, this one would definitely be towards the top, so close enough. Anyway, I absolutely love Interview with a Vampire because it just, I think, is the OG vampire movie. Like, obviously there was Dracula and Nosferatu and all that stuff that, like, literally came first, but I feel like Interview with a Vampire was the first time that vampires were actually portrayed as, like, fully round characters that you actually get inside their heads and understand, like, what it's like to be a vampire. Obviously, like, vampires are like a stereotypical theme of the Halloween season, but I think what's really cool about Interview with a Vampire and Anne Rice's versions of vampires in general is that they draw attention to the concept of what it would be like to trade in your humanity in order to live forever. And I think this is a concept that goes a little deeper than a lot of your stereotypical like Halloween-y type of concepts, because as human beings, our worst fear is death, and it's the biggest mystery that we have in our reality, as well as like sickness and old age and all of that sort of thing. And in Anne Rice's versions of vampire stories, vampires essentially are these like almost flawlessly beautiful, eternally existing, eternally healthy creatures that is kind of what all humans kind of sort of want. But then there's the dark side to it, because in order for them to become these amazing creatures, they have to give up aspects of their personality to a point where they end up having these insane psychological battles with themselves about like what is right and what is wrong and whether it's even worth it to live forever and have to see everything dying around you. It's just a whole freaking thing. Not to mention that Tom Cruise and Brad Pitt in that movie are just literally at their prime, and that's the way I will always imagine them, even when they're decrepit and old, because they're not really vampires. Speaking of Anne Rice, movie number four is Queen of the Damned, which in my opinion is not anywhere near as well portrayed of an Anne Rice rendition as Interview with a Vampire was. Having read the books of both of those, I can say that there are clear discrepancies between both of the movies and their respective books. They're both kind of wrong in certain ways, but like Interview with a Vampire is more serious, and it kind of like really paints the characters in the best that they could do in that short of a movie. Whereas Queen of the Damned for me is almost in the same category as The Crow. Like, part of the reason I like it is just because it's so indicative of its time period. You know, Aaliyah is in it, you know, shortly before she passed away, so it's like a blatantly early 2000s kind of vibe. The fashion is just very like early 2000s goth. It's very cheesy in its own way, but like my inner child is like, yes. You know, I try to re-embody that as an adult, but essentially what's great about that movie is that it's kind of just a fun and not too serious vampire movie. Like, you kind of just, you let your inner child or your inner teenager kind of take over, and you don't have to go too deep with it. It's kind of just like, yeah, we're gonna sit here, we're gonna light some candles, and we're gonna watch some weird rock and roll vampire shit because it's gothic and early 2000s, so like, why not? Movie number five is The Picture of Dorian Gray. So like, the actor, Stuart Townsend, who played Lestat in Queen of the Damned, also at some point played Dorian Gray in The Barrage of Unusual Men, or whatever the hell that movie is called. And he's just as cute in that. Just gotta say, there are vampires in that as well, but it didn't make the list because It's not one of my favorites. So anyway, getting back to the point here, the picture of Dorian Gray, whether you watch the like early 2000s one with Ben Barnes, or if you find like the weird older renditions of it from the 70s and stuff like that, it's pretty much all the same story. It's about this guy who preserves his own wealth and beauty by like giving up his soul into a painting. It's a very similar concept to what we just talked about with Interview with a Vampire, but it's also just like ridiculous and insidious in its own sort of way, because he's not a vampire. He's not actually sucking other people's blood or their souls or anything. He's just like incredibly narcissistic to the point where it destroys himself and everything around him. And what's cool about this is, again, it's really like a shadow work concept. It's about really taking a look at the way we balance light and dark in the human experience. Like, we value these things like youth and beauty and wealth and power and indulgence, and, you know, for good reasons, because those are good things. But when you're willing to give that up in exchange for like being a decent person, and then like in the movie, he just gets to see like the painting version of him becomes grosser and more decayed with every terrible thing that he does. It kind of just draws this direct view, this direct parallel between like, how do we stack our values? How do we balance the light and dark in our lives? And is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? Do we need to take it super seriously? Or do we need to be more playful with it? It's just, it really gets your wheels turning. And it also gets you thinking like, what would we do in exchange for the ability to never die or get sick? You know, like, would we do something that, like, sell your soul, or, you know, something that could be harmful to yourself and others on a spiritual level in order to not have to experience those, supposedly extremely terrible things about the human experience? It's like, humans are so afraid of the concept of death and old age that it's like, what would we be willing to do in order to make that not happen? And does that literally take away our humanity? Does that make it no longer worth being human? It's just all kinds of questions, guys. You just gotta watch it and ask yourself deeply rooted questions. Because, you know, shadow work for the win. So movie number 6 is The Lost Boys. This is another one where I really can't think of a deeply spiritual reason why you need to watch it, except for that it's a deeply spiritual experience to get to see like grunge / goth / punk style, you know, rolled into a freaking movie from the 80s. Like, it's like, it's different from like the 90s goth and the early 2000s goth kind of style. Like, it has its own distinct 80s-ness to it that is just priceless. And, you know, they're freaking vampire lair, man. Like, it's just, my inner teenager wants to have that vampire lair with all the just candles everywhere, and it's dark and dreary, and everybody's wearing weird 80s outfits and stuff. It's just, and then the girl has this like gypsy outfit. Like, I can't not love it. Just, it's one of those ones, just pop popcorn, drink yourself some cider. It's really just for fun. Movie number 7 is Death Becomes Her. It was just so absolutely ridiculous, and it is a comedy, so it is kind of like funny, and, you know, just that 90s fashion is just so freaking good, and it's a lot of fun in general. But at the end of the day, it still manages to raise those exact same questions that we talked about with Interview with a Vampire and the picture of Dorian Gray, because it's kind of like more of like a modern girly approach to the exact same type of story. So basically, these two girls are like so obsessed with youth and beauty, and they're extremely superficial, and they end up kind of like selling their soul so that their body will stay young forever, and like they'll never like die. But in exchange for that, if for some reason something happens to their body that would have caused them to die by, you know, something other than old age, then they actually start to decay and become these zombies. And of course that happens right away, right? Because it's a comedy. And it's just a lot of fun, and but it raises those same questions, and you're like, yep, that's a constant theme with shadow work. What would I give for youth and beauty? Obviously wouldn't necessarily take a risk as big as the one that they made. That was kind of stupid. But, you know, I might be willing to become a vampire if like Lestat or Eric Northman was willing to turn me, but definitely not like a zombie person. That's just not cute, guys. It's just not cute. Movie number 8 is The Ninth Gate. Now, this is again another just really like 90s vibe kind of movie. In case you haven't noticed a pattern, I really, really like things from the 90s because I think it was a beautiful time for fashion and art, but that's probably my inner child talking. What's really interesting about this movie is that unlike most of the ones we talked about so far, it really has to do with the devil. You know, it's that really sort of dark, reverse Abrahamic sort of view of witchcraft and magic. Kind of like Rosemary's Baby. And it's like, I really don't relate to that at all. It has absolutely zero zilch to do with my worldview. But having come from an Abrahamic religion when I was a kid, it just has that little bit of rebellion in it that's like, yeah, I like this movie that's about the devil. It's weird and interesting. I think another thing that I love about The Ninth Gate, other than the fact that it's Johnny, need I say more, but it's also because it has to do with books. Like, in case no one has noticed, like, I'm obviously a bibliophile. I absolutely love collecting just weird, vintage, old occult books. Actually, to my right, you can't see it, but there's an entire shelf of, like, weird vintage occult books, and it just having to do with the fact that it's November's Eve season, which is autumn time. An autumn season for me is very deeply rooted in the concept of like education and reading and being a bibliophile. Just watching this weird movie about Johnny Depp discovering a dark witchcraft by pursuing an ancient occult book. It's just the perfect combination of my favorite autumn themes. And why not, dude? Sell your soul to the devil in exchange for an eternity of collecting occult books. Guys, I am going to wrap up here. Having obviously left out like Hocus Pocus and The Craft and Practical Magic, because honestly, in my mind, even though The Craft and Practical Magic are some of my favorite witchy movies and November's Eve is generally associated with witches, as someone who's a witch year-round and, you know, knowing that those movies actually take place in the springtime, it's hard for me to just randomly put them on a November's Eve list. Hocus Pocus, I have to give an honorary mention to because it is the ultimate Halloween movie of, you know, my generation, but I just couldn't put it on this list because everyone puts it on that list and I needed to do something different. Thank you so much for listening to me ramble about my favorite Halloween / November's Eve videos. And if you are interested in digging deeper into the concept of November's Eve and like understanding why shadow work is important, why we have to ask ourselves really deep questions like the ones we talked about with Dorian Gray, definitely consider joining me for Boss Witchery 101. It's a program where you learn the basics of witchcraft and not the kind you're going to get in a random witchcraft 101 book, but the kind that is specifically designed to help you to actually live a better life, to manifest better things into your experience, to learn what your life's purpose is in any given moment and make yourself a vibrational match to it pretty much instantly. And it definitely touches upon the wheel of the year and goes into depth with the kind of energies that you should be working with at each one of the 8 checkpoints on the wheel of the year so that you are vibing at your highest frequency, living your best life, and manifesting the shit out of your existence. So if that's something you're interested in and you're curious, see the link below. So I would absolutely love to know, what are your favorite movies for the Halloween / Samhain / November's Eve season? So if you have favorites and, you know, there's a specific reason why you feel like it resonates with this time of year, even if it's a little outside of the box, I would love to know. Let's get a conversation going in the comments. And I will talk to you guys in the next video. Until then, November's Eve blessings, happy shadow work, as well as happy watching random and fun Halloween movies and not doing any shadow work and drinking cider and eating popcorn just because you can. I will catch you next time. Until then, blessed be.